I rise to support the union budget in letter and spirit, and I want to put my observations forthwith. Sir, क्या है ये सब? ये का तरीका है क्या है? सर हम लोग कोई दंगल तो कर नहीं रहे, आप आग्रह कर लीजिए।
Nothing is going on, Lord. आप बोलिए।
Sir, the budget is always a consultative process, and where do we? So, sir, I cannot speak like this. I'm sorry.
कुछ रिकॉर्ड में नहीं जा रहा है। आप अनुभवी सांसद हैं, आप नहीं, समय की सीमा समाप्त होने के बाद आपको स्वयं बैठना चाहिए। चार बार आपको समय दिया गया। नायडू, यू आर वेरी 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 सीनियर एमपी नाउ, प्लीज सिट डाउन। यू आर बैठ जाइए, आप प्लीज बैठ जाइए, कोऑपरेट विद द चेयर, प्लीज बैठिए। गल्ला साहब बैठिए, आप भी बैठिए, नानी साहब बैठिए, आप बैठिए, आप प्लीज।
अरे भाई,
ओ भिदुड़ी साहब, भिदुड़ी जी, भिदुड़ी जी, भिदुड़ी जी, प्लीज।
आप
वरुण जी, आप तो प्रारंभ कीजिए।
सर, द बजट हैज ऑलवेज बीन अ कंसल्टेटिव प्रोसेस, एंड whether it's industry leaders, whether they're experts, whether it's social scientists, important voices have cooperated in the presentation of this document. 72 countries, sir, all over the world are indulging in participatory budgeting today, which basically means that citizens prevent their governments from unilaterally putting forth, and they present their civic policy preferences and priorities to negotiate local budget allocations. Sir, I was recently in Brazil, and I was in the city of Porto Alegre, which is supposedly the best governed city in the world, where neighborhood assemblies, community organizers worked with participants to identify proposals for capital investment. So my question is that can the government initiate a new kind of budgetary process slowly, with pilot projects expanding forth, where we share our economic and financial position with certain sections, with delegates that have been elected by community organizers, by several parts of the country, and then offer them a forum for some kind of public demand? Is it possible, sir? Because I think that the government's budgetary spending would be more closely tied to actual needs. Were that to happen, it would make the budget more representative and accountable. So my next point is on wage inequality, which remains a serious obstacle towards social and inclusive growth. So in India today, I was looking at the fact that we were the first developing country in the world to put the Minimum Wage Act in 1948. But till date, sir, there is no directive to the Minimum Wage Act. If, for instance, we look at the fact that 30% of workers are not really protected by the law in any manner, the fact that there is no provision in the Minimum Wage Act 1948 to cover all workers. So if we go deeper into this, there is a scheduled employment and a scheduled job category. Scheduled employment is a sector, so tea plantation, mining, etc. And a scheduled employment refers to a job type for unskilled workers. Now, in the state of Mizoram, sir, there are only 3 scheduled employments, where in the state of Assam there are 102. Does that mean that in the state of Mizoram people are only doing 3 kinds of work? It's something for us to think about. Even when we look at the significant variations between the lowest minimum wage rate, which in Delhi is 538 rupees and in Nagaland is only 115 rupees, assuming cost of living, etc., are different, but even then, sir, the range difference between highest and lowest minimum wage rate in a given state in Kerala is 905 rupees and in Nagaland is only 16 rupees, which means whatever kind of job minimum wage rate you do in Nagaland, it's only just 16 rupees differential. How do you standardize this? So my request to the government is that we declare a national floor level minimum wage rate and incorporate it into the Minimum Wage Act 1948 through revision. Because this will make it statutory, it will act as a benchmark for increasing minimum wage, and it will give workers rights to agitate and protect their demands at will. Sir, can we have a universal basic income in our country? I quote 2 studies of Seva that were done in Dindori and Ali Rajpur in Madhya Pradesh, where it showed that in the 62 villages that were taken, 90% of them escaped informal debt by becoming producers, whether it's of cloth, whether it's of kullards, whether it's of milk, etc. So an unconditional basic income has served to reduce child labor, to produce sustainable increases in income, and also to reduce informal debt from money lenders, which is a vicious trap that we all know about. Sir, the British Economic Gazette says that in the time of Rajas and Maharajas in 1925, 1% of India owned 25% of India. Sir, today 1% of India owns 73% of national wealth. And sir, the poorest minimum wage laborer will take 941 years, sir, to achieve what a top executive earns in 1 year. So when I want to discuss compensatory afforestation, I congratulate the government on the success of the Ujala Yojana, which has entailed distribution of 35 crore LEDs. But I would like to add that can we replicate the same model for solar stoves and battery chargers? So there are millions of people who are living off-grid electricity today. It will prove a major boost to them, both in terms of light and fuel, reduce our LPG burden, etc. So when we talk about afforestation, the environmental laws are old. So 90% of environmental laws were made before 1947, the ones we're carrying on with. So they are confusing, many of them contradict each other. Can we have the best minds in our country sit and write one law for the forest, wildlife and the forest people, and another set of best minds to write a codified law for the environment, which is increasingly becoming an urban issue today? Sir, can we have an institutional restructuring? Forested India, sir, accounts for 21% of India. But increasingly, when you look at, sir, the forest service, they are demoralized and in decline. Sir, the working mechanisms of the forestry service must be similar to the army or to the police in terms of training and new methodology. We can have specializations for wildlife, tourism or protection, and it must be a specialized service. Sir, you cannot have a forestry service official working in the passport office or in the RTO. It doesn't make any sense to me. So when we talk about financial independence, in the CAMPA authority, the Compensatory Afforestation Fund Management and Planning Authority, the Supreme Court has collected 54,000 crore rupees today in terms of what we call NPVs, which is net present value of forests that have been used for non-forestry purposes. So today all of this is lying with the ad hoc CAMPA authority. Not a penny has been spent. If we can once again bring the best minds into this and do a national afforestation program together, I think that there would be a lot of value add in this. So wildlife towns need to be boosted. Sir, Ranthambore in Sawai Madhopur had zero revenue before 1985. Today it has a revenue of about 500 crore rupees a year, just one district. So if we look at Bharatpur, Chandrapur, Chikmangalur, Jabalpur, etc., across the country, can we not convert these into model green towns, mix them with the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan to put the best waste cycling processes in these towns, and of course put tourism in them? So on national employment policy, we need a national employment policy to lay out what kind of jobs the government, good quality jobs the government seeks to generate through investment and skilling methods. A roadmap for these quality jobs, also with tax incentives of entrepreneurs and reducing the regulatory burden. So a statistic is, it costs 26 lakh rupees to create one steel job in the country. And it costs 1 lakh rupees to create 9 textile jobs in the country. What we should be investing in is very clear to me, sir. When we look at the fact, sir, at an employment guarantee, sir, Europe was almost completely bankrupt in 2013. Greece had 60% unemployment, Italy had 50%, and Spain had 45%, sir. So Europe spent 3.5 billion euros putting an employment guarantee scheme where they said we will do three things. Either we will pay for your further education till you get skilled, or whatever skill you have, according to that we'll give you a job. Or the third thing is we'll give you a traineeship or apprenticeship, according to which you can get a job later. Can we do the same, sir? Can we create a national employment grid if a company in Patna, a construction company needs 300 welders? Cannot we create a national employment grid where welders from Bhubaneswar can go and then work there? I mean, we need to now start thinking of big solutions. I want to end, sir, by talking about agriculture. It is true that the MSP hike fixed at 50% over A2 plus FL cost of production is a good step for Kharif 2018-19. However, the economic survey itself says that only 29% of crops are sold at MSP. So can we do two things? Can we introduce a landmark legislative intervention on right to sell at MSP? If we do this, I think it will save a lot of lives, sir. Also, sir, I read reports consistently over the last 10 years that over 20% of farmers, particularly in areas like Bundelkhand, etc., are not aware of MSP, etc. Can we do that? Sir, I just want to end with two points. One is, we've spent a lot of time, sir, talking about water. But we reward states for behavior that is not best practice. Sir, Madhya Pradesh has got double the water footprint for wheat of Uttar Pradesh. Punjab has got double the water footprint for paddy of the next state which has procurement. But we do maximum procurement for these crops from these states. Can we work with these states and the farmers to try and institute a different kind of aligned cropping process? I want to just end by two things, sir. There's a lot of talk about organic agriculture. Sir, two things. One is the decreased capacity of farm produce for organic agriculture has to be dealt with, otherwise nobody is going to do it. The second is the increase in the cost of nutrient basis when compared to NPK or fertilizer. You need 3 times the amount of organic manure, sir, than for inorganic farming. How do we deal with this? And the last, sir, is for the rural population to escape money lending. We need penetration of formal credit through rural finance corporations. So I want to end by just saying that this is a government which I believes in emphatic social transformation rather than incrementalism. Together, let us build a new India. I hope that with this budget, we start a new pathway. Thank you.
Press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update.